Hi everyone, welcome to the 7th episode of In Person. We are here at Nature Mart in Delhi at the exhibition Material Scars by Asim Waqif. Asim's practice traverses the fields of art, architecture, design, ecology. And for this show, he brings together a group of new sculptures where he again combines organic and industrial materials and along with this new set of cyanotype prints that he's put together. And welcome, Asim. And for this, the one thing that I would like to start with maybe is, because this is something that you've spoken about in the past, is how, the sort of process of conceiving this show and as opposed to, conceiving the show for a space, for a gallery space like this, as opposed to the public art installations that you do, or the other kind of public spaces that you exhibit in, or have you made work for? So, if you could just begin with that.
Yes, so I've always been a little scared of the white cube space, which is what the gallery provides. I actually started interacting with galleries much after I had started doing my arts practice. A lot of my work is very site specific. It draws on a lot of research about the place, about the people. While gallery space is actually designed as a neutral space, I always found it really tough. It kind of works for people who have a strong studio practice, because then the work is produced in the studio and then it's exhibited in a gallery space. So the sort of removal of context kind of helps in that. But for me, it was a little tough for a long time. So I did my first solo in a gallery much after I did a solo in a museum, for example, doing an installation. At the same time, I think I want to be part of both domains, the gallery space as well as the non-commercial art space. Because the gallery, at the end of the day, it's like a dukan. They are trying to do the commercial aspect of the art, art gestures or art works. Which is really important because I do want to earn a living from my arts practice. But what I find is that quite often the gallery becomes so important, or money becomes so important, that the arts practice then gets curtailed only into a gallery space. So I want to be on both sides. I do a lot of work outside the gallery, which has no prospect of selling, no even idea that it will sell. It's more for the experience of the viewer. While the gallery space is more a mix, but they kind of inform each other. A lot of prototypes from the gallery end up as installations, or things that I started working in large-scale installation end up as objects in the gallery space.
Okay, maybe you can walk us through some of the works.
Sure.
And
so this is a good example, actually. This kind of process I started, I've been working with bamboo and cane for a long time, but I did this really large-scale installation in Calcutta two years back, where I worked with cane and bamboo craftsmen over an extended period of time. So here, actually, I've tried to use that kind of a process, but for this work, I worked with craftsmen from Nagaland and Assam. So actually, I went to Dimapur and firmed up a partnership with somebody who's already into cane manufacture. But of course, their manufacturing is more furniture, or craft, or object-based thing, and I wanted to do some experimental sort of thing. So initially, I sent them some drawings, and then I actually developed a 3D model of what I wanted to make, because it was really difficult to communicate in drawing this kind of a twisting, turning form. But at the end, I just had to go there and work with the craftsman. So this is made using only cane from Nagaland. And the black is actually a natural dye, dyeing process that has been done on it. And in some way, this exhibition is actually, for a long time actually, I've been trying to look at apparently destructive or negative processes as a way to create something. You know, so for many years I was looking at decay, dereliction.
Mm.
This show has a lot of crumpling in it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, twisting, crumpling, manipulation of form with kind of force, even violence, I would say. So this actually is based on what's happening right now in the Central Vista. The photograph at the back is of the construction that's happening right now. It's about, like, the photograph was taken about 2 months back. And it's kind of juxtaposed with a map of the design that's been proposed by HCP Design.
Mm.
But there are a lot of corollary things that are happening around it. So for example, in IGNCA, there are all these trees that have sort of been brought down for the development. So I was looking at some of these trees, and some of the ficus trees had very interesting root forms.
Mm.
So that's where this sort of a crumpled form started from, in terms of kind of juxtaposing this natural thing which has been broken down for construction, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So, and also trying to mix very industrially made things with very natural sort of almost crumpled kind of forms. Yeah.
And with, I mean, these in relation with the cyanotype prints, because this is a new, I mean, this has been a series of new experiments, right?
Yeah, I got introduced to cyanotype from the Maze Collective, Ashish Sahu and Zara, only 3-4 months back. And it was just a period of perhaps some inactivity where I was exploring other kind of things.
Mm.
And I mean, cyanotype is something that I did even as a student, kind of unknowingly, because I studied architecture and used to do all these blueprints and things, you know. And so initially they taught me very, you know, the standard way of doing cyanotypes. But then I found actually that using that process to create photograms while even manipulating the material on which it is going to be printed, you know, so some of these are shadows of the paper on itself, actually, which has created all these forms.
Okay.
So this paper was crumpled and twisted in different shapes and forms. Like, this is more like a, you know, sort of this, like trying to create different folds on the paper after it's been coated with the cyanotype material.
Okay, okay.
Exposing it to the sun. And then,
okay.
Yeah. While in these ones, actually, I've also tried to introduce other shadows. So, for example, if you look at this, these lines are made because of the shadow of a prototype I was working on in my studio.
Hmm.
And it's a very light cane and sarkanda structure.
Okay.
And so the day I was printing this actually was very windy. So the structure itself was also shaking. So I wanted to use those kind of environmental factors in the way the print gets created. You know, so it's still a nascent experiment, I would say. I want to work more on this process.
Yeah, one thing I'm interested in, I mean, what I wanted to know was the word analysis comes a lot in your titles.
Yeah.
And I mean, if you'd just like to speak about that, I mean, in your approach, as opposed to something which is usually used in, say, scientific sort of, I mean, say, related fields, even urban planning or say some kind of scientific experiment. Is the word analysis when it comes in?
Well, yeah, I think the analysis aspect is more, it's to sort of show that this is actually not for making that object.
Okay.
It's trying to do some process, and the object is a sort of a byproduct of it in some way. You know, so it's actually trying to analyze how things fold, crumple, how shadow falls on things. And I'm not doing that to make this, but actually I'm interested in understanding that, and these are kind of byproducts of that in some way.
Mm. Let me speak a bit about this. Are these photographs mounted as well?
Yeah, these are photographs that are directly printed on the aluminum composite panel using an advertising technique called UV printing.
Okay.
So you can do UV printing on actually almost any material as long as it's flat.
Mm.
And these are pictures of buildings that were demolished by court order because of ceiling in Delhi. Ceiling has had a long history in Delhi, and also it has a very strong emotion attached to it in terms of, you know, how people sort of, you know, people's sort of attachment to a place or a space, and then suddenly it's demolition. And the demolition is actually in the guise of following law, you know. And there are many buildings like this in Delhi, but somehow in our day-to-day lives, we have chosen to ignore them. So they kind of blend into the grayness of the city. So in some way, I'm trying to bring that back. While the bamboo is, well, I've been working with bamboo for a long time, but This bamboo I planted in my father's house back in 2010 or 9, I think. And over the period of years, I've harvested it, seasoned it. So I've also gotten to seasoning. Seasoning is a very complicated thing, actually. Today, seasoning has almost unilaterally been replaced by poisoning. If you look at any timber or bamboo.
What is seasoning? I'm sorry if you could just...
Seasoning has got to do with two things, traditionally. One is controlling the humidity content in the timber.
Okay.
So it matches the ambient outside.
Okay.
So that... It can require slow drying or perhaps even soaking in water for some time and then slow drying. The other thing is to control starch or any nutrients that insects would be attracted to. So okay. To limit the amount of insect attack on any timber or bamboo, different processes were done to make it like less palatable to insects. So what's happening today is that almost all timber and bamboo, even the ones that are marketed as sustainable or eco-friendly, they're all pumped with industrially manufactured chemicals which are mostly attacking the digestive system as well as the the exoskeleton of insects, borer insects. So I was somehow not so convinced about that process, so I started researching vernacular seasoning because we have a really rich history of seasoning of bamboo and as well as timber in India. And for example, like in Meghalaya, I've seen houses that are about 60-70 years old, about 75-80% made out of bamboo, in pretty good shape. Of course, they require some maintenance and some, but still in very good shape. So I started researching that, and there were a lot of things in that which I could not really understand. Or one thing was, for example, bamboo was usually harvested during a particular phase of the moon, And when people, practitioners were asked, why are you doing it? They said it's an auspicious time. So the whole scientific reasoning process got completely debunked that and they said that that's just superstition or whatever. But actually it's been shown in the last 20 years that the phase of the moon has an effect on sap in most plants and trees. And the waning phase of the moon is when there's less sap. So if there's less sap, there's less starch, and starch is what insects are attracted to.
Okay.
So this has been seasoned in that way. So you have to look at the solar cycle, what time of the year, the lunar cycle, the time of the day. And then we usually harvest it, and I put some barrier like a katori or something below, so no insects can climb up, but let it stand in the grove. So the leaves continue to do photosynthesis, but there's no nutrient coming from the roots. So what happens is that the starch that is there in the bamboo kind of breaks down into a something like a vinegarish kind of a compound,
okay.
Which is the natural preservative. Then it's slow dry. And then, and in some way, I guess I want to juxtapose like naturally grown things with man-made, things. So that's what this work is about.
I mean, that one as well. I mean, if you were, is that...
So this is also, I mean, I'm a collector of sorts in the sense that I keep collecting things. And these pieces were collected after a huge forest fire in Mukteshwar.
Okay.
This is Anyar wood, which is a very hard wood, and the forest fire also has a very complicated kind of a history. Actually, if you look naturally, most forests have a natural cycle of fire and then regrowth, But because of pine plantations in Kumaon, so this is collected near Mukteshwar and Kumaon. So now pine, you get turpentine, you get this sort of lisa, it's called lisa, which is like a sap that comes out of the tree trunk, and that's collected and it's made into turpentine and many other oils also. So sometimes it's what happens is that if you light a fire, it becomes so hot that more sap will come out, so you'll get more quantity but less quality of the lisa. So there are a lot of man-made fires also that are happening. This is a picture of building that was demolished in Imphal way back in 2008, I think, which was actually a barracks. And those barracks were made by destroying something else like 150 years back. So it's like a sort of continuing cycle of making and destroying and making and destroying kind of thing. And I think it's really important to actually destroy things to make things. So I'm not so bent on like the hardcore conservation kind of mindset, but everything has to be preserved, nothing should be built around it, because I think kind of a living, growing, changing city is more interesting than something that becomes a museum, for example.
It's also inevitable.
Yeah, in it's inevitable, but the thing right now is that power structures are able to break it.
Okay.
But individuals in their capacity are not allowed to do it. And usually power structures are very greedy and individuals are sometimes more innovative, I think.
I think we can...
This is another bamboo I grew. This one I grew in my balcony. These are bones that I found on treks. So this is like rib cage. That's like a skull. This is a horn. That's a vertebra. That's a molar of a cattle. Like I said, I've been just collecting things. Some of these bones have been collected like many, many years back. And even this piece of junk from Mayapuri, this is like a car radiator. And this was also sourced many years back and it was lying with me for many years. So sometimes I just collect things and then very intuitively put them together into some forms. Yeah. So, and then sometimes after putting them together in some forms, I forget about them and then I go back to them and I make something else out of it. So this, yeah, used to be a sculpture of different form, different things like way back, and now it's become this. So I like that kind of accumulation and change because I think a lot of times there's too much pressure on artists to finish an artwork and then it's like, you know, done. Well, actually I like more processes, trying to do something, maybe something works, maybe it doesn't. Maybe it works at a certain time frame. In a certain context, it doesn't work in another time frame, another context. So I like to keep changing in that sense.
I mean, on that note, I mean, is it, what else are you working on right now? Is it?
Well, there's one really long-term project I'm working on in Bangladesh, in Sylhet. That's like a 20-year project. We are 5 years down right now. So there, I've grown bamboo. And as the bamboo is growing, I'm kind of manipulating it into different forms. So it's going to be like a living, growing sculpture.
Okay.
And then we have we also created a small lake there for certain reasons, because bamboo doesn't like being too like submerged by water, but it likes to be close to water, and that was a kind of a waterlogged area. So I dug a lake there and used that earth to make mounds. So we have a lake as well as these mounds, and then in the lake we've introduced fish and frogs and snakes, and other things just came by themselves. So it's kind of becoming like a very rich ecological rich space. Yeah. So that's happening, and then I'm working on some other sculptures. I'm also working on some other commissions. But frankly, a lot of the really large-scale, interactive, projects that I've been working on, that has suffered in the last 1.5 years, because people are more reluctant to let anybody touch anything or touch it themselves. A lot of my installations were actually designed to reward curiosity. So if you view it as a passive viewer, then you see a certain thing. But if you are curious, you go touch things, you jump on things or whatever, then other layers are revealed. So that has suffered in the last 1.5-2 years. But now things are looking up, I think, and I hope in the future we'll do more of that.
Thank you. Thank you, Asim.
Thank you.
And tomorrow is the last day for this show. And for anyone in Delhi who would like to visit. And thank you for joining us.